λουλούδια.
Most Reverend and Holy Vladika, very Reverend and Holy Geronda of this wonderful monastery and this wonderful school associated with the monastery, brothers and sisters, students, it is a great joy for me to be here. It is one, I should say not one, the greatest event in my life in America. There are many other good things that have happened since I came here, but this, my association with this school and this wonderful church, of which I knew very little, but I came to know much more, just as it happened with some other people that I met in America, some of the Oriental churches that I came closer, especially the Coptic Church, for various reasons. I will explain to you on another occasion. But in all these cases, I think Vladika said a very important thing. He said many important things. He said that the grace of God comes to us through associating with other people. And of course, when you associate with Orthodox people, because the church is not just an abstract thing, it's not an idea, it's not an institution. The church consists of the members of the body of Christ, of Christ himself, who is the head, of the holy apostles, of the saints, primarily of the Holy Mother of God, the Theotokos, but also all of us who have been incorporated into the same body and the same reality. And the church consists of human beings. God also is personal. And that is one of the most difficult things to explain, which the holy hierarchs that we celebrate, St. Basil, St. Gregory, St. John Chrysostom, or should I put it the way the Russian icons have it? It's St. Basil, it's Basil, St. Chrysostom. This one has Basil in the center, which is unusual. There is a reason, obviously, for the different icons that I find in the way they are aligned. The three saints. That would be a nice paper someone should do in hagiography, if you're doing hagiography. Write a good paper on why we have different variations in the icons of the three hierarchs. Because there are actually priorities in each one of them when you compare them to the others. And that's probably why. The priority of St. Basil, I'm sorry, I'm digressing from what I'm saying, the priority of St. Basil is that his liturgy actually dominated all the churches in the first millennium. Today we have St. John Chrysostom. But it took 900 years before Chrysostom actually came home, because he was mistreated, he was exiled, he was condemned by a synod, but he was restored in the most amazing way. I'm not going to go into this detail. But maybe in the end, a few things I want to say, I'll come back to him and tell you what is the significance of Chrysostom, as I discovered in some of the synaxaria I read and studied recently because of his great anniversary on the 1600-year anniversary, which was celebrated the year 2007. So I come back to the persons that Vladika mentioned, meeting persons, meeting Orthodox, and receiving the grace of God through other persons. That is exactly the mystery of the three hierarchs. And what kind of persons are they? What is a person? They spoke about the Holy Trinity as being the one God is in Trinity, Trinity of persons. The tropario, the apolitikion, begins with the three cilios, theotis, three sons, the Godhead of three sons, or a triple son, reflected also in the communion that the three hierarchs represent, because they have in themselves shared in the same doctrine, which was established as the foundational doctrine of God. The Holy Trinity, God in Trinity. They provided the clarification that had not been done in the first Ecumenical Synod. And the second Ecumenical Synod actually followed St. Basil, and more St. Basil, but also St. Gregory, and of course St. John Chrysostom came afterwards and did not have to deal with it, but to expand on the meaning and understanding of God for the understanding of humanity, which is his own contribution. How the understanding of God has an impact on the understanding of us human beings. If God is personal, and if we find out what this means, and we are made in his image, then we are personal, and we can find out what this means by learning from God. Now, that is the first thing that the Apolitikion says to us. If you pay attention, because the Apolitikion, which really means dismissal hymn, it is translated as dismissal hymn, it's the last hymn in the Vesper service, which is the first service of a new day. Why is it called a dismissal hymn? What is the meaning of this? It means that it summarizes the significance and the meaning of the feast. And the first thing that the Apolitikion says is that these are three luminaries, tus tris megistus fosteras, the two greatest luminaries, the greatest luminaries. Now, what is a luminary? If we could translate it differently, the two stars, the three stars, the greatest stars. Human beings, actually, in the tradition, from the time of Abraham, and that's what the fathers say, are associated with stars. When God showed Abraham, so the fathers say, in their exegesis of that story, which is well known to all of us, when God showed Abraham the stars of heaven, and he said that he would bless him and many nations, his children will be, the children in the faith, will be like the stars of heaven, luminaries. Is there here a clue to understand what is a human person? Oh, yes. We are not exactly like God, because only God is a person, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. There is a difference between the sun and the stars. The stars receive light from the sun. And the Holy Trinity is the triple sun of the Godhead, which actually is the source of our own identity and existence. We are luminaries, we are stars when we receive the enlightenment of God, the glory of God, when we are glorified by his glory, when our potentiality, being in the image and likeness of God, becomes a reality, an actuality. And that is what these saints really represent to us, the luminaries. They are the stars of the Holy Trinity. That's why they were able to speak about the Trinity and also to reflect in their theology and in the legacy that they left to us in the church, a legacy that unifies people on the basis of the glory and grace of God. I come back to this, which I picked up, and it was really in my mind to speak about the luminaries and the sun, the triple sun of the Holy Trinity, which is the basic theological legacy of these three great fathers. That is the first point, that we receive the grace of God through other human beings. And the human beings are the saints. And these great three saints, greatest luminaries, have given us the greatest writings on the Holy Trinity. What should I mention? The first great theological writing of Basil, as you all know, was his refutation of the apology of Eunomius. And who was Eunomius? Eunomius was a Cappadocian. Imagine coming from the same place. The worst, as it were, heretic, and the greatest of the fathers come from the same place. Eunomius was the exponent of Arianism, the final, what they call today modern scholars, Neo-Arianism, the final stage of Arianism. Arianism denied that God is Trinitarian. The mystery of the Godhead of Christ, and the mystery, of course, of the Incarnation, that God is not just one single person. God is not, you might say, an egoist, an ego, an ultimate ego, no. But the mystery of God is in communion, Father, Son, and Spirit, a communion which is beyond us, and we can't explain it. That is what St. Basil argued against Eunomius, who wanted to define God, and he produced a definition of God which excluded the Son from being true God. He said, you may remember, and I hope I'll whet the appetite of the students to go and read it, to find out more about it, that God, the Godhead, is agenesia, equal to ingeneratedness. Newman produced the word that was adopted in English, the ingenerate. He is ingeneratedness, that he was not generated. The Greek is agenitos. Basil showed the fallacy of this, of defining God, God's essence, God's usia, God's being. God's essence is unknowable. That was the legacy given to Moses. Who are you? There was no definition of the being of God. That is exactly what is retained in the church. Nobody knows what God is. What do we know then? We know that he is. And how do we know that he is? In other words, we don't have a descriptive knowledge of God, but we know that he exists. We know his existence. How do we know his existence? From the way he reveals himself to us and interacts with us. In other words, through his grace. The grace in creation, the grace in redemption, the grace of life that he gives us, true life, and that is what these three luminaries present to us. The basis of their theology is their true experience and participation in the grace of the triple Son of the Godhead, the grace of God, and light, enlightenment, that is the theme that runs through the Holy Scriptures, through the history of salvation from ancient times, through to them and the later saints, right up to the present. That's the first message of the Apolitikion, of the feast of the three greatest luminaries of the church. Remember that in all times, in ancient Israel, nobody knew the name of God. And even the name that was revealed to Moses, the Tetragrammaton, the four-letter name, which is written in Greek or on in three letters, over the head of Christ, that is the corresponding name in Greek of the Hebrew. Yahweh, 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 I don't know what, nobody knows, because the Jews wouldn't pronounce it. Because they would have trespassed the first commandment of the Ten Commandments given, you must not take the name of God in vain. Now, what is the name of God? Is there a name of God? Yes, it is the name of the Holy Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That is why we cross ourselves, as we all know, whenever we hear, sing, or call upon the name of God, which is Father, Son, and Spirit, then we cross ourselves, we cover ourselves with the cross of Christ, so that we may not trespass the first commandment. The same we do with the Holy Mother of God when we mention a name. And we do it with many saints. Today, I noticed in church, the Russians do more crosses more often. That's good. And I have adopted it, and some people say, are you influenced by Russian liturgy? I said, yes, it's good, and it has a real reason. So, and I could say a lot more other interesting details, because it is by act that you learn how to think properly and what the meaning of things really is. If you do the right thing, then you will learn what is right. If you don't do the right thing, you will never learn what is right, because the mind wanders about. But the right act is the right track for getting to the true knowledge. I'm saying too much. I'll move to the second point, the Apolitikion says. The light is first. And we are not persons, or we are persons, only to the extent that we reflect the glory of God, that we become luminaries, that we reflect the saints, that we pursue sanctification. That's what makes a person. There's a lot of debate today among theologians, including Orthodox, in academic circles, which is an endless debate ad nauseam about what is person. And there are great names of theologians from the Orthodox world, from the other Christians, who all debate what is a person, and they disagree with one another. Well, if you want to know what a person is, you have to approach the Lord, the saints, and allow the grace of God to touch you. Only by experience of sanctification you can learn what a person really is. Otherwise, we are dark persons. A person is not a substantive for us. It's only in the Trinity, according to the Fathers. So when we speak of one being in three persons in God, we must never presume that we can reproduce this on our level, because we are not gods, we are not divine, we are only creatures. So it's only by participation there, and to the extent that we participate in the grace of God, that we may reflect both the unity, the mystery of his unity and Trinity, the mystery of his existence, which is eternal. Only we become eternal if we are in the grace of God. That's the three luminaries have actually established through their doctrine this unity in Trinity in God, which is one light and three lights, and which is reflected in so many things. Again, we saw it today with Vatika being and blessing us with the Triceri and Vicari, with the three candles and the two candles. That's what this mystery, this act, and this symbolism represents. Something which is three lights, but one light. And we sing the Triclinium three times, plus glory be to the Father, the Son, the one name of the Trinity, and then once more for the unity. Lots of things tell us of this. But how do we reflect this in our own life and in our own relations? Are we actually enlightened like the great fathers who did have their differences? They did have some bad moments. I mean, you have to see when Basil became a bishop in 350, and 352, he appointed his friend and fellow monk, Gregory, to the worst possible see that one could have been given. And they exchanged some very sharp letters there. Very sharp letters. Who? Gregory said this to Basil. He disputing his greatness and his friendship, the one who said afterwards, when he repented, that he was so important to him that even everything all around spoke and reminded him of Basil. That the birds sang Basil, that the air breathed Basil. Everything was Basil to him. These are the great hierarchs who did reflect that grace of unity of among human beings, the unity of communion, which approximates the grace of God and makes us gods with small g, and invites us to experience theosis. I would not say much more. I will say the second thing that is given in the Apolytikion. They are not only luminaries, stars, reflecting the light of God, which they receive from him, but they are also rivers. The sun and its rays is one of the images that all the fathers use and comes from the scriptures, comes from the verse, in thy light we will see light. What is the one light? In thy light. Somebody addresses God as light, and he has a light, and that is the sun. And we'll see light in the sun. And what light is this? It's the Holy Spirit, the grace which comes from the Father through the Son and the Spirit, as St. Basil says in his second great dogmatic writing on the Holy Spirit, to prove that the Spirit is indeed God, fully God, and homoousios, with the Father and the Son, as the Son is with the Father. And so, the river is the other one, which is similar, and speaks there of a word which is amazing. It uses a word that we use liturgically, nama. The word nama, namata, rivers which have covered the earth. What is the nama that they have given us? It's the Eucharist, really. Nama is the proper wine that we use in the Eucharist, which is Eucharistized, which is blessed, consecrated, and becomes the blood of Christ. All of them have written liturgies. You may know that there is a liturgy of St. Gregory as well. There is a liturgy of St. Gregory the Theologian. Of course, St. Basil and St. John Chrysostom, we have them, we use them. But there is a liturgy of Gregory, which we don't use in the Orthodox Church. I don't know if the Russians do. But the Copts do. And I was surprised that the Copts were using the liturgy of St. Gregory the Theologian. There are copies, of course, around. And I asked my metropolitan, I said, why don't we, on the feast of St. Gregory, adopt this liturgy, which is recognized by us and which is well known? The Eucharist. The mystery of Christ. There's a lot to say here. What did they do? Both Basil and Gregory, especially Gregory, who gave the greatest refutation of the first great heretic who confused the mystery of Christ. And that was a bishop called Apollinaris. He wrote in two profound letters against to Clidonius against the error of confusing the divinity and humanity and the mystery of Christ, which is given to us in the Eucharist. We don't confuse in the Eucharist the divinity and the humanity. I cannot go into this. But it is the Trinity and the mystery of Christ, the Triceni and the Diceni of Ladika, the two lights, the two great mysteries of our faith, which are reflected in the Creed and which constitute the basis of our Orthodox faith and tradition, and which is reflected in many details in the Church, and which has to do with the shape and form of our own life. We can say lots of things about these great hierarchs who became, in the 11th century, became one when the feast was constituted by a bishop called John of Euchaita. The people had been divided in Constantinople following the Johannites, the Basilians, and the Gregorians. There were three different groups, and they were competing who is the greatest theologian among the three. That's the wrong way to treat saints, the wrong way to treat teachers, the wrong way to treat bishops, priests, abbots, if you put the one against the other. That's the wrong way of dealing with persons and what that each person has to give with dealing with one another, making such distinctions. According to the tradition, St. John of Euchaita saw in his dream an appearance, an apparition of the three, who told him that we worship the Trinity, and we three, worshippers of the Trinity, are one and do not compete with one another. That is what we need to learn, I think, in every aspect of our life. There is a lot more in the Apolitikion and far more in the wonderful hymns, which were written by hymnographers moved by the Spirit which sanctified them, the Spirit which sanctifies hymnographers, the Spirit who constitutes the whole institution of the Church. Ton thesmo is ecclesia. The Holy Spirit is the one that constitutes everything in the Church. That is the legacy, and it is a great legacy. It is the legacy of life and truth, the Holy Church, the Church that unites us all. It doesn't matter if we have some differences in tradition, this, that, and the other, as long as we have the same basis, the same orthodoxy, and our symbols point to it. Sometimes you hear that there are problems between Russians and Greeks, between West and East and West, and all these things. We do hear all kinds of politics. Well, when they ask me, what do you think? I say, well, I can tell you what I know about the Russians. I go to Jordanville. I have made many friends. I know the Holy Abbot there. I know many of the brothers. I know my students. They're the best. What do you want me to say? Russians and Greeks? That's where I found the answer. I have the best to say, these are the Russians for me, and that is the Russian tradition. We must keep it up here. And I hope that I'm a good Greek to the Russians here, or to many others who are not even Greek or Russians, but have joined this wonderful church here, the Russian Orthodox Church abroad. We live in the 21st century. Father Vladimir had asked me to write something for a volume he prepares on the founder of Orthodox. And I found that there were three founders of three different Russian groups in the diaspora. The tragic event, the broken alabaster, which went abroad. What is the task? Reuniting. And not only the Russian alabaster broken, but reuniting all Christians. Because in the 19th century, all kinds of philosophical and other sociological things divided Christians ethnically, from many points of view, politically. And now we talk about many Orthodox autocephalous churches. There's only one head of the church. There's one autocephaly only, which is the real one, and Christ is the head, and we're all members. And there's only one who is the key to our reunion and our salvation. And I hope that this wonderful seminary and this wonderful church will play its role in assisting in this. I think this church that suffered many things, I mean this Russian group, Rokhov, now is given a new lease. And we have to think and pray that the Lord will help this church to be a blessing not only to the Russian church, but to not only to the people here in this country, in America, and everywhere in the world where it exists, but generally in Orthodoxy. If we are imbued by the spirit of the three hierarchs, whatever our tradition is, I think that we can only be optimistic and exuberant about this, the future, and become better students, better teachers, better priests, better servants of the Lord. Thank you.